Previously on the American Justice Podcast.
Nothing good ever seems to happen on any of these numbered roads, especially the film 8 Mile. Worst movie sex scene ever, in my opinion. Not a huge fan of rap either. Mile roads, bad movie sex, and rap equals a hell no from this podcast host.
His palms are sweaty, knees weak, arms are heavy. There's vomit on his sweater already. Mom's spaghetti, he's nervous. But on the surface, he looks calm and ready to drop bombs. But he keeps on forgetting what he wrote down. The whole crowd goes so loud. He opens his mouth, but the words won't come out. He's choking how? Everybody's choking now. The clock's run out. Time's up, over, blow!
There is an epidemic in America's criminal justice system. The prosecution and conviction of innocent people for crimes they did not commit. Welcome to American Justice. The American Justice Podcast Army works to free men and women wronged by the criminal justice system. It's not only about the innocent who have been imprisoned, but also the victims of the crimes as well. No one deserves justice more than them. And now, here's your host, Scott Pogensey.
Hello, AJ Army. Welcome back to your podcast. This week, we're going to be talking about day two of the trial. We'll cover days one and two in their own episodes, but days three and four. Finally, a witness is called to the stand who does not have a criminal record. Breaking the mold, Wisconsin. His name is Mr. Rittenhouse, but we don't know exactly who he is at this moment or what bearing that he has on the case. But don't worry, my dear listeners, I don't know either. Neither does anyone in the courtroom. So we're all in the same boat. Surprise witnesses only happen in television shows aimed toward the most ignorant among us, so, you know, most of the people we know. They're going to skip the phone tower expert because he doesn't have a curriculum vitae, basically a resume for expert witnesses. But he's in the process of writing one, like, right at that exact moment. My money is that he's doing it with a purple crayon and a cocktail napkin. Can you imagine being at a job interview or being the conductor of a job interview and asking for a CV only for someone to whip out some writing utensils and make one up on the spot? This is a goddamn courtroom, or at least it's supposed to be. Maybe it's just decorated as one. Maybe it's really a bathroom that one day wants to grow up and be a courtroom. We can all dream, can't we? So maybe he'll show up later when his crayons run out. All right, so Bradley Rittenhouse takes the stand. Mr. Rittenhouse claimed to be at the American Legion on the night in question. Stop right there.
And now, hang on to your hats. Keep your arms and legs inside the ride at all times. Because it's time for a rider's note. From head rider C. Derick Miller.
As a veteran, I wouldn't believe another damn word that comes out of this man's mouth. There's a reason why beer is so cheap at American Legions and VFWs, so veterans can drink lots of it.
He saw a body lying in a ditch on 4 Mile Road. See, I told you nothing good ever happens on these numbered mile roads. He turned around and took a look at it and knocked on the door of the home that it was in front of. Now this makes this situation even worse. The body was not discovered at like midnight or 2 a.m. It was discovered fairly early in the evening. What in the hell was this man doing at the American Legion so damn early in the evening other than to drink himself into oblivion? At least the body in the ditch was real, this time.
I'm not harping on this witness, veterans, or people with drinking problems. I was slash am a hardcore alcoholic, and we can smell our own. Literally. I'm also a veteran. I know what I did when I went to the VFW early in the evening. It was the same thing as everyone else, trying to get a head start.
What follows are a ton of witnesses being led by the prosecution. Not once so far in the chronological transcripts has the defense objected to any of this, nor does the judge take notice. As a matter of fact, I believe I can count on one hand the number of times that anyone has objected to anything during the first day of this trial or jury selection. Is anyone awake? This is unusual for court cases. Anyway, the potentially drunken VFW witness knocked on the door for a couple of minutes, but no one answered. Rittenhouse went back to his vehicle. He repositioned the car so the headlights would shine on the body and called 911. He didn't touch the body, and he didn't check for a pulse, and noticed the body wasn't moving and saw no signs of breathing. He reminds us all it was January in Wisconsin. Cold. Very cold. His opinion was that the person was deceased. Again, no objection from the defense about leading the witness or the witness not having the credentials to determine whether or not somebody was alive. He wasn't a doctor. He had been hanging out at a bar and didn't bother to check for any vitals on the person lying in the ditch before his very eyes. What if Stephanie Goins was still alive at this point, freezing to death on the ground in a Wisconsin winter? What if this witness could have saved her life by simply performing some type of CPR or merely covering her with a jacket? What if this lack of actions is what truly killed her? I'm not saying that this would be the case, and I just prefer to question everything.
Remember, kids, throwing shit against the wall to see what sticks is a hell of a lot better than just standing there with a handful of shit.
Finally, the defense gets to cross-examine the witness. I'm not going to hold my breath for anything that remotely resembles legal proceedings. I can almost imagine the sound of rustling pom-poms as they approach the stand. The one thing the defense mentions from Mr. Rittenhouse's police report was that he had his family with him that night and that he did touch the body. He swears he didn't, which means his initial police report is inaccurate. Also, his family? Sure, maybe a wife, but family? Family to me implies the children were present, so let me get this straight. He brought his kids to the bar? How does that even happen? Looky here, Timmy. Want to see how fast your old man can chug this beer? Wisconsin is a scary place and it has little to do with bodies lying in ditches. Of course, nothing comes of this and the witness gets to step down. I've said it a million times before and I'll say it again. A public defender's reduced rate gets you their reduced time, their reduced effort, and their reduced education. I've seen it with my own eyes dozens of times. Those people all went to jail. Finally, the cell tower expert hands in his resume. His hands probably still smelled of the purple crayon. The defense reminds the judge that there was a pretrial order not to be adding documents, witnesses, etc., all willy-nilly after the trial had started. Is this not the judge's courtroom? How embarrassing would it be to have a defense attorney remind a judge of their own rules in their own courtroom? This makes me wonder whether or not this judge truly cares about legal proceedings, and I question the entire trial from here on out, as if I wasn't questioning it before. This is truly a circus without the peanuts and the monkeys. All documents and witnesses were supposed to be made available 21 days before the beginning of the trial. This guy's name was handed to them on a sticky note on the Friday before. No exaggeration whatsoever. I may be taking liberties and even attempting to humor when I say the resume was written on a cocktail napkin in purple crayon, but I'm serious as a heart attack when I say that the witness's name was truly handed to them on an actual sticky note on the Friday before trial. This is the level of professionalism we're dealing with here, ladies and gentlemen, in the year 2006 in an actual courtroom. The defense is clearly stating that the state has failed to hold up their end of the bargain, but the judge is fighting like a cornered animal to keep everything as it is. Maybe it's because the defense is, once again, speaking as though they're at a 80s Valley Girl convention with all the likes and you-knows and what-ifs. Perhaps that's a poor analogy. I'm just saying that I consider the language used several times in the court transcript to be unbecoming of a professional on the record. Then again, perhaps I'm just used to listening to attorneys who are more articulate? Also, every courtroom I've ever sat in was in the state of Texas. Articulation and Texas shouldn't belong in the same sentence, but it's the absolute truth. The words banging off of the walls in this Racine County courtroom probably resemble the speech of a yoga studio dressing room on a high school night, if there is such a thing. They argued about this shit the day before as well. The exact same thing. I was wondering why this argument sounded so damn familiar and thought for a second I'd jump back to an older part of the court transcript. Yes, this is the exact same argument the judge, the defense, and the prosecution had on the day prior. Yesterday, chronologically. So, why was this a no-no yesterday, but the judge is telling everyone to mind their own business today? Wishy-washy much? Split personality problems? Memory issues? Maybe it's just situational convenience to make sure that the accused never walks free again. Either way, it's unprofessional as hell, and an embarrassment to anyone who works in the legal field. The state finally argues that all of this information was available while Mr. Repishak was on vacation, rolled up on his desk, but available. Was the defense team just supposed to stroll into his office, dig through his desk, and take him? This is very similar to what the aliens did to the humans before destroying their planet in Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. It didn't stop them either. The original witness list had Dina Navarro as the U.S. cellular witness, but it changed to an engineer instead at the last minute. Now, the judge claims that the state never sent a witness list at all. Oh my dear Lord. Even though the defense and prosecution attended a meeting with Dina Navarro, the map couldn't be deciphered without the assistance of an engineer. One was not made available until now, and the sectors on the map were vital to the defense. There's also no way to know if the defense would need an expert to argue Tim Baker's knowledge. He's relying on a computer program. This is a problem, or at least it should be, if anyone involved truly gave a shit. They decide to bring in Baker for an order of proof, and for jurors to be instructed to, quote, smoke them if they got them. Seriously, the judge instructs the bailiff to tell the smokers to go smoke. Racine County, Wisconsin. Encouraging lung cancer and emphysema since 2006. The judge states that the door to the jury room is a good one, but she doesn't want them to turn the volume down on the microphones. The jury can more than likely hear what the witness's order of proof, and no one seems to care. At all. Not since this whole damn trial began, day in, day out, and some of the best is yet to come. Worst of all, and I know that you're tired of hearing all of this, but the defense never seems to care enough to object to any of the things going on that could potentially hurt their client. Tim Baker is a senior RF engineer for U.S. Cellular. It said so on his resume. Clear as purple crayon.
And now, hang on to your hats. Keep your arms and legs inside the ride at all times, because it's time for a rider's note from head rider C. Derick Miller.
I was a site team leader for Nortel Networks a few years before this trial commenced. Most of my coworkers knew little about how the stuff worked, but they could tell you a hell of a lot about PlayStation and weed. What follows are pages and pages of telecommunications jargon from the early 2000s without the presence of the jury. It's a witness voir dire, and it would put you to sleep. It was putting me to sleep as I wrote it, and I actually attended years of telecommunication schools. Yes, to all the listeners out there, I've lived one hell of a life. Military, telecommunications, law enforcement, writer, and fine art logistics. My tombstone will look epic.
Here's an example. Question: how did you generate this map? Answer: we have a propagation software tool called Planet, and we put in our database of how tall each tower is, what height the antennas are, and what type of antennas they are, what transmitted power goes into the antennas, and then each of the towers it projects out 360 radius around the tower as to how the signal degrades from the tower to each of the road locations, and that's all combined and projects this coverage map. You can hear the snoring already. Tim Baker informs the court he received his subpoena a week ago. Yes, only a week ago. The map in question was brought to the attention of everyone the day prior to this one. Not quite 21 days per the pretrial order, but I'm not a math teacher, so I can't say for sure. The data contained in the map, however, has been available for a long time. So why did it take so long to get it to the court? Easy, because Tim Baker chose to drag his feet. Again, no one truly seems to care. The witness steps down, but the argument continues. The state claims the information was always available to the defense, but the defense claims they had no way to interpret his information without the newly provided map and witness. Ultimately, the judge sides with the state, which shows no damn surprise on the faces of the American Justice podcast, and allows the testimony for the tower, but not the map. So it's a 50-50 win? The judge puts all of the blame on U.S. Cellular. Luckily, U.S. Cellular isn't on trial in Racine County, Wisconsin, or they might be in jail for the rest of their lives. Instead, the judge will make him use a regular-ass street map. In the end, what's the difference? All this time in voir dire, and we went nowhere. These are our tax dollars hard at work. If by chance any of us lived in Racine County in 2006, I'm truly sorry if any of you did. Please don't get in any trouble there. Drive the speed limit and don't shoot anyone. Don't even be in the general vicinity of anyone getting shot. Just stay at home and lock your doors. From now on until the end of time. Best advice I can give you at this point. Wait, there's some life in those good old dogs yet. The argument continues. Not just between the defense and the prosecution, but the judge as well. Isn't the judge meant to be the be-all, end-all of arguments? Why is she a participant? Make a ruling already. So help me God, if I don't get some objections during this next part of the trial, I'm going to scream on my own. Now, the judge has changed horses in midstream and is ruling on the side of the defense, not allowing any testimony on the new information. The state is pissed, and I can tell that from reading a 15-year-old transcript. I bet the defense did some high kicks in their general direction and made up a little chant. Did I mention that my mind is in a very strange place? Give me an F. Give me a U. Give me a... All right. Reginald Templin takes the stand. Wait, what? What in the hell happened to the telecom guy? All that arguing for nothing? I quit. Well, not really. Vinny deserves better. Templin works for the state crime lab as a firearm and tool mark examiner. He has testified as a firearms examiner approximately 300 times. an expert in microscopic examination of individual characteristics. He's asked to identify Exhibit 14, which is a lead bullet of a .38/357 supposedly connected to this case. These were the bullets collected from the body and the telephone pole right next to the body. He testified that they were fired from the same gun. So whoever shot Stephanie was also a bad shot and shot the telephone pole as well. The other exhibits were not suitable for further examination because they were too damaged, except for those two bullets. The defense cross-examines but conducts a useless, time-wasting dance like all the others in this case when they know that there's no place to go. The witness is obviously well-educated and experienced in firearms, ammunition, and manufacturers. And, as far as we're informed, he wasn't drinking at the VFW all day long. Jackpot! The defense brings a green and pink jacket to the expert's attention. This is the jacket that Stephanie Goins was wearing at the time of her death. He was asked to examine this as part of the case. The expert witness found no gunpowder residue on the jacket. He states that all handguns stop leaving gunpowder residue at a distance of 3 feet. I know this now. I'll know it forever because the defense asked the expert witness about every model of handgun. 3 feet seems to be the universal answer. Perhaps they believe the jury will fall asleep if they bore them enough. It was true that a few of the bullets fired were from the same weapon, but that weapon was never found. Here I am discussing that fact with Nick from the True Crime Garage.
And in Vincent's case, there's substantial evidence, I believe, that shows not only that there was reasonable doubt, but it shows beyond any doubt that he didn't do it.
And you're right. And with, you know, beyond the ear witness, and I, you know, you have the court transcript. Mm-hmm. And that's one thing that I didn't get when I was digging into this. And I think one thing that I found very interesting about his case is, okay, unfortunately, this young woman, our victim here, was shot and killed. So we know that a gun was involved. Didn't the police go to where Vincent was living and confront his family as well and confiscate any guns that they found on the premises and confiscate any guns that they found at family members' homes? And didn't they try to match one of those guns to the bullets that were fired that night? And what do we have? We don't have a murder weapon, do we? We go to trial, we don't have a murder weapon. Okay, well, people dump murder weapons all the time. You would expect somebody, whoever killed this young woman, probably dumped the weapon somewhere. Or it's stashed underneath their bed in their home and we've not found the right guy yet. So there's one big problem.
All right, so Dr. Bierdezicki takes the stand. The list of names that are difficult for this host to pronounce just keeps going on and on. Do you know how many times I had to say Bierdezicki to myself? It's spelled B-I-E-D-R-Z-Y-C-K-I. Bierdezicki. Okay. So this is the doctor who performed the autopsy. What did the good doctor think of Stephanie Goins? Here's how he described her.
She was a 22-year-old black woman, appearing normal for her age. She was 65 and a half inches tall, 154 pounds, and there was no evidence of medical therapy. There was no evidence of disease, but there was evidence of injury. And those injuries were basically of two kinds. There were gunshot wounds, and there was a blunt injury to the face.
The doctor believed the injury to the face was from falling to the ground. There were 7 gunshot wounds total, 3 to the back of her head, 1 to the shoulder, and 2 to the lower back, and 1 to her hand. The doctor then demonstrates the entrance and exit wounds of Stephanie Goins' body, but there is no microphone where the demonstration is taking place. Everyone is screaming once again so the jury and court reporter can hear them. Yes, I'm sure this was the year 2006. Again, there was no gunpowder residue on the body, leading him to believe the shooter was more than 3 feet away. The doctor goes through what I've come to believe is standard autopsy reveal at a murder trial. There is little to be discussed during cross-examination or redirect because there was very little evidence to begin with. To be fair, the only thing connecting Vincent to this entire case is someone else's certainty that they heard his voice on a telephone call. But you already knew that. Here's a clip from my conversation with Nick from the True Crime Garage, just pointing out that one more inconsistency when it came to the expert testimony. Would someone please tell me why Nick and I are able to question these things better than the supposedly trained defense attorneys?
Now, one thing that I did find that said the ballistics expert that testified at the trial testified that three 38 caliber bullets were recovered from our victim and testified that they were in fact fired from the same gun. However, you and I both know that there were several more shots fired than that. There were seven total. And what I'm a little curious about, because again, I don't have the trial transcripts, and maybe this is something you've not got to yet, we're only testifying about three bullets. What's up with those other four? I know you said that there was one in the telephone pole, but are they different? That's where I'm starting, you know, you question something.
Right.
Were they a different caliber? Was there more than one gun used? Why are we only testifying about three bullets? Or again, it's from what I could find, Scott. Mm-hmm. But I found no mention of some of the other bullets that we know were fired that night.
Well, they did say that the seven slugs that were recovered were of the same caliber, but they couldn't tell if they were from the same gun. It was the only reason that they knew that these casings were the same is because they recovered these cases. They didn't cover all seven casings. That was the problem.
Okay.
But they were able to say that the seven slugs that they found in the body were of the same caliber. So you can't, you know, the striation test and the manufacturer test and that kind of thing, those are usually done on the casings. So, you know, there's all indication that that she was definitely shot seven times in succession from the same gun.
All right, with the good doctor's testimony coming to an end, so does day two of the trial. Not a lot of fireworks today, but don't worry. Next week, we'll start with part one of day three. And maybe we'll get to hear from the cellular expert. All right, Army, we'll see you next week. Until then, don't forget to stay aware, stay strong, and get involved. See you next week.
The American Justice Podcast is owned and copyrighted by Atua Productions, LLC. Your host is Scott Pogency, and your writer is C. Derek Miller. The theme music for the American Justice Podcast has been created and composed by Josh DeRosa. Atua Productions aims for this to be an interactive podcast where you, the audience, has a great amount of influence on the content of our shows. You can interact with us in several ways. First, and most preferred, is you can leave us a voicemail. Our phone number is 972-942-0444. Be sure to leave your name and the city you're calling from, along with whether or not we can use your voice on the air. If Facebook is more your style, you can log on to our Facebook page at facebook.com/AmericanJusticePodcast. Feel free to leave a comment, or you can message us on Messenger if you have a more pressing question or issue. If you would like to blog about the show, then you can log on to AmericanJusticePodcast.com and tell us what you think there. You can find many of the documents discussed in this episode there as well. If you are a tweeter, you can also voice your opinion on Twitter at AJusticePodcast. If you would like to support the show, you can do so in a couple different ways. First, consider visiting our Patreon page at patreon.com/AJPodcast. We have different levels of support that include t-shirts, guest call-in spots, and early access to our podcast and YouTube shows. Next, you can like, subscribe, and click the bell icon to get notifications of when we publish episodes. We would also very much appreciate it if you could give us a 5-star review. If you have any comments about the show, or more importantly, any tips on the case we're discussing, please call 972-942-0444 and leave us a message. After all, if the subject of our podcast is innocent, that means someone out there is guilty. American Justice Army? Let's find them.